The following is a video interview that's part of the USMC VTA History Project. And we're recording the interviews at the VTA reunion in Washington, D.C. on October 30th, 2015. We have with us today Rick Walters. And Rick, would you please tell me when you were in country, the unit you were with, and then your story?
Okay. when I was in country, it was end of 1968. It was the Vietnam Express. I got enlisted in the spring of 68. Spent 2 months in Paris Island. Went to a month of ITR, Infantry Training Regiment, in Camp Lejeune. Then they wanted to send me home for a month. I think I stayed for a couple weeks. Next stop was sometime in early December, staging, and then the next thing I knew, I was over in Vietnam at the end of
68. Okay. Your MOS was?
My MOS was non-tanks or non-ontos. It was 0351. And what that was, back then, was the weapons platoon for an infantry company. And they trained you for the 3.5 rocket. I guess they would have trained us with laws, but they were too expensive. A flamethrower and a recoilless rifle.
Okay.
And it's a close MOS. The Antos was 0353, so it was a couple of digits away. But they were having a lot of rotations coming up at the end of 1968, beginning of 69, where they were letting a few people go early back to Camp Pendleton or Lejeune, or a stateside, I should say. So they grabbed quite a few people that came off the plane that were 0351 and made them Antos crewmen.
And we were an Antos crewman.
Right, and I was very lucky. And what happened was, I guess, when 12 or 14 new guys showed up, I don't know if it was the OCs or the platoon sergeant or the senior section leader, somebody decided to grab certain people. At any rate, they grabbed me for 3rd Platoon, which was actually sort of a combat platoon. At this time, Antos was a reinforced company called Alpha Company with 15 Antos. So they grabbed me, and this I didn't really realize that at the time. But 3rd Platoon didn't have to stand inspections. If they were doing junk in the bunks or were being inspected or looked at, they sent 3rd Platoon out back in the field and kept them out of the battalion rear. 1st Platoon supposedly was the inspection platoon, and they hated that. But at any rate, I got in with a good section. Either section would have been fine, the heavy section or light section. Heavy section was A31, A32, and A33. 33 went to the senior sergeant or senior OC or tank commander, Antos commander. I was on A35, pretty colorful tank. They named it the good, the bad, the ugly. It was a pretty quick Antos. They had removed the governor on it. Instead of doing 35 now, it could do 55. Ran real well. I didn't realize at the time, it had been over there since at least 67. So it had 3 years of running on a time, and which was pretty long life for an Antos. You know, not that they hit mines all the time, but sometimes they rotated them back, or sometimes they were deadlined. But they stuck me right in the driver's seat. So that was a pretty good thing. I didn't know how to drive. They just said, pull this lever, the left one. If you pull it hard enough, it goes left. You pull the right lever, if you pull it hard enough, it goes right. So naturally, I was going like left, right every 10 feet. But within a few minutes, I got the hang of it. And you know, it was almost like a boat. There was no brake on it. You just give it gas, it goes. You take your foot off the gas, it stops. Because they're geared to go, you know, whatever, 30 miles an hour.
Yeah.
So if you just have your foot on it a little bit, you're going 1 mile an hour.
Good.
So at any rate, they put me in that. But what I was going to do is just give a little bit of history of the Antos battalions, because I read up on it. We had certain people that had extended over there. We had one person like Boston or Bruce Manns that actually did, I guess, one tour with two or three extensions. But he had real continuity in a way. He was there in good portion or most of 67, all of 68, and in 1969. So you would learn a lot just from the ones that had been there. And all the OCs or people that trained me were there in 68. And I think all of them except one, my OC, extended. So they were all of 68 and part of 69. And they taught me a lot of things. So what I was going to do is just give a little bit of history about the early Marines. And when I say early Marines, some of these Marines were in when JFK was president. They made the original landing in 1965. And, you know, I don't know if Red Beach is necessarily a real hostile fire zone, but they came over on these LSTs or LSDs. In the last 100 feet, they had to drive through 3 or 4 feet of water, as well as with the tanks. But they landed there, I don't know if it was March of 65, May of 69, but 3rd ATs was the first one ashore. And with the Antos, it really just shows that the Marine Corps, it's hard to understand sometimes. They put a company, Alpha Company 1st ATs, TAD, the 3rd ATs. And they really got their marching orders, and we have another Marine here, Michael Provisano or something. He was with them in that early year, and he swears his mail address was 3rd ATs, which it may well have been. But the 1st ATs was TAD to 3rd ATs for at least a year, which is a long time. Yeah. At any rate, 3rd ATs made that landing, came into Da Nang, and I think when they first landed, Vietnam was pretty disorganized and almost like a free fire zone, and nobody knew exactly where anybody was going. Well, for some reason, they pretty much secured the jet strip, stayed around the Da Nang area. But I think shortly thereafter, 3rd Marine Division made a left-hand turn and decided to go down to Chu Lai. Then they decided to make a right-hand turn and go up to Phu Bai. So before you know it, this whole coast, which hadn't seen any soldiers, and I don't think the French were that great, and I know the popular force, the Vietnamese, were terrible. This was all Indian country. So 3rd ATs was in Chu Lai, in Da Nang, in An Hoa, which is southwest corner of Da Nang, and in Phu Bai Way, all within the first couple of years running around. At the same time, sometime in 66, 1st ATs brought over, say, the 7th Marine Regiment. They landed, and then Bravo and Charlie Company, the other two companies in 1st ATs landed, and they quickly took over Chu Lai. Well, it sounded like pretty good. Now we had organization. Well, not so fast. 3rd ATs was moving north to a place called the DMZ. And their kickoff place was going to be certain places like Camp Evans up in Quang Tri, which 1st ATs later went up to by mistake. And then later on, a place called Dong Ha. And then, of course, you have all these famous places like Kantian and Leatherneck Square, Gia Linh, all these places on the Qua Viet. That was all 3rd ATs, and they actually wrote the book on Vietnam, and 1st ATs actually followed them in quite a few steps. One of the most famous steps is, you know, when they went down to Chu Lai, they didn't stay there that long. They stayed maybe 6 months a year in 66, but as 3rd ATs was moving up to Phu Bai and Dong Ha, 1st ATs took over their nice EM club, a nice little battalion headquarters called Hill 34. All built, all night, ready to go. And that became their new home. And I think likewise with tanks, as it turns out, ATs were taken over by tanks in 1967, 68. 1st Tanks took over 3rd Tanks Battalion Rear on what they called Four Corners. And when I was there in 69, that's where 1st ATs was. So at any rate, sometime in 67, 1st ATs now had Chu Lai, Da Nang, An Hoa, and maybe a little bit north, Hai Van Pass, as 3rd ATs moved up to the DMZ. Also, this is two different types of wars. I mean, they had some big battles there. 65 was Starlight, strictly 3rd ATs, plus Alpha Company 1st ATs, TAD. Very big battle. The Marines did very, very well. Went wrong, a number of things happened. The Antos really helped out in a lot of ways. They lost a couple, one or two tanks, but the Antos did fairly well. And somehow, the planning of the operation went awry that they had a whole regiment trapped, but they quickly regrouped, got the Antos going well as a blocking force, and they actually pushed the VC out toward the sea. And they got hundreds and hundreds of KIAs on the other group. And this was the first battle, and this was 3rd ATs. And as it turned out, third EETs was basically going to write the book on Vietnam and what was going on.
And what worked well.
Right, exactly. And they developed the tactics and everything else. But what happened here, that was a pitched battle. As it turns out, Da Nang was never going to have too many more pitched battles. It was going to have mostly hit-and-run operations. Or if you found them, the VC would stop and fight for a while. But it was completely different than when they went up north. And they also got a contrast. When our unit went up north to Camp Evans and Quang Tri in 1967, they were completely surprised when they had battles with the NVA. They would stop and fight for hours, and the battle would break off when the NVA wanted to break off. Usually it was the reverse. The battle would break off when we got fire superiority, the VC, or whomever we had in Da Nang. But as it turns out, 1st ATs took over that area in 1966-67. And then, as I said, I joined them in late 68. But the people that trained me, they had an accidental discharge, and it's pretty important. There was a convoy, and something went wrong where a 106 must have destroyed three or four trucks on a convoy. And 1st Marine Division was very, very upset. And they did something called an administrative deadline. The Antos was not allowed to fire its 106 until they could sort out what that accidental discharge was. Well, according to the command chronicles, this went from March 67 all the way up to about September of 67. And at that point, Alpha Company again was traveling, and so was some of the 1st Marine units on something called Operation Checkers to relieve some of the units up in the DMZ. So the first place they went was a place called Quang Tri, and it was a pretty tough place for them because they'd go out the gate on the base up there and they'd actually get ambushed. Yeah. So what happened here is 1st ATs went up there. They were out of, 1st Division's tour, Da Nang, and all bets were off now. They were using the 106 all the time. And it also got very, very bad because of that accidental discharge. They couldn't carry the tubes loaded, and this actually hurt them when the Tet Offensive kicked off in February of 1968. They lost a few Antos because they got ambushed, and they had to stop and load their tubes. Mm-hmm. And that was called the Road to the Graveyard from Phu Bai to Wei on a convoy. But the Antos that went up in 67, you'd look at the command chronicles, they were firing 40, 50 rounds a night, supporting the infantry in an operation called Medina. They were back in the killing business. They were doing real well. But they had two companies down in Da Nang, one company up north, and whatever rules that 1st Marine Division was making didn't apply to 3rd ATs. They would try to impose that the Antos shouldn't be firing, shouldn't be carrying loaded rounds, and supposedly a 3rd Marine Division general said, I gotta have my Antos. He said, with them, my convoys get through. Without them, they don't get through. So whatever rules they made for 1st Division because of the accidental discharge never applied to 3rd ATs. So you could see that 3rd Marine Division or 3rd Marine up north was a different type of warfare than the warfare down by Da Nang. And they had a different set of rules, it seemed like. So at any rate, 1st ATs, just to give a little more history here, was in Camp Evans in Quang Tri, say October, November of 1967. On December 15th, I don't know if they were phasing out the Antos or they felt they weren't getting enough supplies or they couldn't get enough replacement Antos. They went from a full battalion, which was 45 Antos, 15 per each letter company, Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, and they reduced it to 15. Now the command chronicles say December 15th was the changeover. Well, we had a lieutenant in here yesterday, Lieutenant Louis. He says, really, we were doing that back in October. And that makes sense. They're writing down the records. Nothing ever exactly happens on one day. But they were prepping the vehicles, cleaning them up to ship them back to Barstow, United States. So nobody really knew it real well, but he actually made a good point that they were trying to select 15 to keep and return 30. Except they probably didn't have 30. Maybe they had 25, 27, 28. They didn't have a full TO of 45 vehicles. But what was important there is nobody remembers that chapter in history, how these Antos got returned or how it happened. But it was pretty much common sense that if you're returning, I don't know, 30 vehicles, 28 vehicles, whatever the number is, you're going to return your worst vehicles and keep the best. So Captain Louis filled that in. The other important point was, whatever happened here with first ATs on December 15th happened to third ATs. So what happened is they were reduced from 45 vehicles. The lieutenant can attest to it. First ATs, it's pretty much documented that Bravo and Charlie Company never went north. It was just Alpha Company. And they actually took two of the lieutenants. I've met them and worked with them. Lieutenant Morton McCann went from Bravo Company to Alpha Company, served all of 68 and part of 69. And the same thing happened, that they were reduced also on December 15th. The other important thing is they were up at Quang Tri in Camp Evans in December. They decided to move them down to a new base called Jai Li or Phu Bai Combat Base, which was 3rd Division's base at one point. When Way City kicked off, or Tet Offensive kicked off, on January 30th, a lot of the Antos from that 3rd Platoon were on bridges, and they couldn't put two per bridge, they could only put one. But whatever bridge, steel bridge, that the Antos were on, it might have been 15, but they might have had 8 on these bridges, remained standing. I mean, the Antos got beat up or shelled or RPG'd, but stopped their human wave attack or sapper attacks. But when one of the platoons, 2nd Platoon, was basically like a stone throw away from Way City, they didn't know there was 5,000 NVA in there. They just started up 5 Antos, said, you got to go to the MACB compound. They started driving in and started getting a lot of, a lot of fire, small arms fire. While the Antos weren't stupid, they didn't stop and fire their majors. They just sprayed and prayed with a 30 caliber. But they had 5 Antos and they were driving fast. They went right through like it was the flight of the intruder in Hanoi. It was like a rat patrol or something. But they went right through from one side away to the other side. Once they got into the MACB compound, they learned shortly thereafter they weren't going to be taking Way City until they started getting some, couldn't even get battalions up there, rifle companies up there. But the amazing fact was, here was Jai Li, here was Way City, and they drove straight across. Meanwhile, 3rd Platoon was just south of them, and only a couple kilometers. They wouldn't risk 3rd Platoon driving up Highway 1. They felt it was too risky. They moved them down to a deep water pier, and they floated them up 2 weeks later, around, or not 2 weeks later, 12 days later, on February 12th. But the two things I remember here in 68, it's not necessarily my time, but the people that trained me, it was their time, was they had two major battles, or two major offensives, or one was Way City, which was a major, major battle in the war. Went on for 30 days, started out with, a couple of companies from, I think, Foxtrot Golf from 2-5, Bravo Company from 1-1. I became friends with one of the commanders there, and it ended up, they finally got together maybe 2 full battalions, but there were 4 or 5 different letter companies, not run at a TO of 200, maybe 120 men, and over a 30-day period retook that, and by some pretty good estimates, somewhere in 30 days of fighting, both the new city, which was built up, and the old city, which is sort of the imperial city, and more 200-year-old, two-story brick houses, 4,000 or 5,000 NVA were killed, and which is a staggering number, and I'm sure they had much more higher estimates on the wounded. And they retook the city, and then they had quite a few operations after that, mopping up the area. The 101st moved in, set up a base. But meanwhile, up north, they had their hands full in caisson. And when they're always talking about 90mm M48 tanks they had up there, they had 10 of those, 175s, we had 4 of those. They would cite the Antos that they had 10 Antos, but it was 6106s. They were doing some quick math. 6106s per Antos times 2 platoons, which is 10 vehicles, equals 6106s. So somehow they were trying to show their firepower, and they were multiplying it times the guns. So whenever you read the defining year or history of 1968, they always list the statistics that we had 6106s up there, 60 guns, or 60 cannons, that were 106 millimeters in diameter. But Caisson was a siege. We got pictures of the vehicles. I was wondering, did the vehicles ever get hurt? Well, we started. I started reading the command chronicles and the damage done to them, and I've seen pictures. They got hit all the time, and what they would do is shrapnel would hit, and it would take off one of their cannons, or was damaged so they couldn't fire. So you'd saw many, many pictures of Antos with five cannons, four cannons. And you also saw many pictures of Antos being driven out that they had to change track because a piece of shrapnel hit the track and broke the track. So, I mean, if a piece of shrapnel hit the slope plate or the armor, you know, it destroyed the jerry cans or whatever was on there, but it didn't penetrate the armor. But it broke up the Antos on its cannons, weapon systems, and on the track, and probably put some dents in the fenders. But there was an awful lot of repair orders in that 3 or 4 month period where they were shelling it. Another fact is that's probably the closest warfare that they ever saw that was like World War I. It was almost like trench warfare where they were, we were getting shelled to death. So it's a testament that up north, it was a different type of war. It was almost like it's more conventional, and it was trench warfare. And you know, it was just that was the war. The Marines always had a saying about it. It was going to be your turn in the barrel. Mm-hmm. So 3rd ATs had 10 vehicles there, and they had, I think, 5 vehicles up at Cantien. Neither place was a fun place to be. But that was another period where they were socked in, and they were firing. And they were doing some long-range firing there. They were firing up on a mountain somewhere, which nobody thought they could hit. And first time they missed, the second one they did a 5,000-meter shot and hit the side of the mountain where they wanted to hit. They were firing their guns up there. But they were there for 3 or 4 months in that siege. And then when they relieved it with this convoy or Operation Pegasus, for some reason the Antos didn't get their orders to leave right away. They were the last unit to leave Caisson, and it was in July sometime, with no infantry support, 10 vehicles driving out. And on the way out, one of the six spies hit a mine, and they had a retriever there, which was just a glorified six spy. And they said, leave it, we're not gonna stop and pick it up, because they just felt it was too likely to get ambushed. But they were the last unit to leave in the end of July. And just goes to show you that the Antos crews were cocky and salty. And you know, when you think about it 40 years later or 50 years later, you should just say, couldn't we have been one of the first ones? Yeah. So 68, and then they did their operations after that. So at some time in September, 1st ATs moved down to Da Nang, and the monsoon season seems to start a little earlier down there. It starts sometime in October. Sometime in October it might have started. November, they're flooded in there. December, they're starting to like dry out a little. The sun is coming out. And some days, because you have good days, some days you have bad days. That's when I joined them in December of 68. And then immediately, they made me a driver. And then immediately, seemed to have 90 degree days. And it was a searing sun. It was yet to get hotter. And you know, it wasn't too bad at first. But then we'd be going out to some early warning system at 1st Tanks had. It was called the OPs. I think the technical word would have been observation posts. We thought that meant outpost. So when we went to all of them, it seemed like. But we'd go out there with the Antos, and they'd say, oh, we think we have movement. So certain nights we'd fire 40, 50 rounds, but we were only carrying 18. We'd run out of ammunition. Well, 1st Tanks was very gracious. In the middle of the night, they'd send a six-by out full of 106 rounds. And I didn't think about it now. I thought about it then. I really wouldn't want to be the driver. I mean, the action was not necessarily where he was, but there was no road swept. There was no security. He was driving up there. They would open the gate. They'd bring him up. And then we'd have the infantry run up and bring these crates, which are 2 rounds to a crate, probably weigh a quick 100 pounds. And we'd open them up and, you know, we'd start firing again. But what was interesting about that was we were firing a lot of ordnance for an Antos because we only carried 18 rounds. But we'd fire, 25, 35, 40 rounds times 2 because it was a light section. But the next morning, I'd have to go back to tank battalion. We get a, we actually fairly well supplied. We get a 55-gallon barrel. It was cut in half, and they'd actually have solvent in there. And nobody ever heard of gloves. You put your hands in there, and after about 30 minutes, they turned to like shoe leather, and they'd hurt. But the thing is, you had a wire brush. I think you might have had a bristle brush somewhere. We're pretty lucky. And you just started to decarbonize those guns. But the thing is, you had six of them. And you, for some reason, the Marines, you had to make things spotless and no shortcuts. You could start at 8, 9 in the morning. You were still working on them at 4 or 5 at night. And you were speeding up because you wanted that vehicle operational at 5 o'clock to go out. So what happened here is we had our fun that night. But the next day, you were cleaning away. And then what happened was the OC and the other Antos, George Spaulding, was out of Way City, a gifted OC or tank commander. He was very calm, and he was the best OC or tank commander I ever saw. You know, he would move the guns, he would shoot things, he'd get things done. As it turns out, he went to the DEA for about 33 years, and very talented Marine. I learned a lot from him. He would be there washing, or whatever, cleaning the guns, and I'd be cleaning my mine. He was the OC or tank commander. His driver was sort of worthless. I was a driver in A35. His Antos, by the way, was A34, called Six Reason Why. And for some reason, when I look back on the pictures, we have a bumper or a serial number, say 226-707. He got four Antos in a 3 or 4 month period because the numbers kept changing. What they were doing is they were surveying them, giving him a refurbished one. But I don't know how. I guess they liked him so much they give him one, and later on they'd say, can you give that to somebody else? Or, and he didn't complain. He would just, you know, do it. So he'd be cleaning the guns on A34. I'm cleaning the guns on A35. My OC would disappear. My OC was Henry Kennedy. We called him Pappy. He was all of like 26 or 28 and balding a little. And had a bushy mustache and long hair. All of us seemed to be, didn't shave and didn't get haircuts because we were always out in the field. And he was very personable. He was always very nice to whichever lieutenant we had. He'd actually let the lieutenants drive the Antos, and I would actually tell him, don't do that. The reason being is if they broke the track, I'd be changing it. And it was easy if you drove over something, like a pagoda, or some rocks, or do something wrong, to break track. So at any rate, you know, that didn't work too well. Good old Henry, or Corporal Pappy, we called him, was looking for a promotion. As it turns out, Pappy was not necessarily the best OC or tank commander in the world to have. He had been over there in 67. I think his Antos got RPG'd to death, and he spent a year in a hospital in Yokosuka or something in Japan. He got out. He got orders to go back to Vietnam. So he was there 6 months, got wounded, a year in a hospital. He had a 4-year enlistment, and they sent him back to Vietnam. But he had been up north. Nevada Eagle with the Army, and the, you know, it was like a year-long operation after Way, and up in that Fubai Jili area, and they were sweeping out, and this was just north of the Ashau Valley, areas that nobody had been there before, or NVA sanctuaries, and they were good-sized operations. They were making a lot of contact, and he had done 3 or 4 months, but now he came back to Da Nang. He was down, or I think he had done maybe 9 months. When he came back to Da Nang, he had 3 or 4 months left. Now, when I caught him, he was down to his last 2 months. He did not want to be there. So he was not, you know, not cleaning guns. And if he was in a firefight or we were firing, you know, he did not like being there. He just felt that he had a near-death experience when his first tour, it was too short. And I think he could just feel it, that something was going to happen. And it sure did. What happened was they're coming into the new year, and it was a Tet Offensive of 1969. And we had those different, every other night we're out on the OPs firing, and it wasn't bad. I mean, we had a lot of firepower. We're up on a hill, we're shooting down. But occasionally we'd be, and the grunts would call us in there. Occasionally we'd be out there loading, and we weren't really pressed that it was a desperate situation. So we got sloppy. We didn't move the Antos back. And you know, we just took our time loading, hop out, load, got back in, a matter of like 2 minutes and 5 minutes instead of 2 minutes. But what happened is they were getting small arms fire, pinging off the tubes and off the Antos. So it was a situation was, and we, I didn't notice it at the time. Later on, the infantry said, did you feel those shots going by you? I said, no. I said, I can't hear half the things. They said, well, they were pinging off your tubes, off the fenders. And we always had like little dings in the not the slope plate so much, but in the fenders, on some of the turrets. It looked like it was ball-peened. It was a 30 caliber round or a 7.62 hitting it. So at any rate, you know, I was told that they were shooting at us. So it was a semi-dangerous situation. So I went through 30 days of that. But sometime on February 23rd, the jet strip almost got taken. And this was just south of Da Nang, And it wasn't tactical at all, because it was probably a real good stone throw from Highway 1, had a lot of barbed wire around it. But the end of Jones jet strip had another dirt road, but it was 50 feet away from a tree line. So it just really wasn't a really good tactical setup at all. In other words, if you were gonna, you know, attack it, you could get within 50 feet before somebody saw you. So supposedly the NV were almost on the jet strip, and the only thing that was holding them up was two MPs with a Jeep with a sky-mounted M60. So First Tank was actually in charge of this. So they were communicating with the Southern Defense Command, which was like south of Da Nang, the headquarters. It was called the Rocket Belt. And they decided to call on the Antos. So the Antos were all around Da Nang, Haivan Pass to the north, the bridges south going toward Hill 10, Hill 37, the OPs going west. And as it turns out, I think we were down on Caldo Bridge on Highway 1. So we just had to drive straight up the road. We were there. But the great idea here was you had 15 Antos there in less than 15 minutes. And 15 Antos is a lot of firepower. So when we got up there, we had a choice of like two or three lieutenants and one to be in charge. I don't think we ever saw a company captain, which that's all we had was a captain. We didn't have a colonel or a major in charge of our new little battalion or reinforced company. So I think they figured out that one of them was in charge. When the M48 showed up, you know, normally the M48s were the bad dog or big dog on the block. They told the M48s to go to the end of the airstrip in Highway 1, and you were going to be our flank security. So what happened was the 48s are flank security. We weren't going to have a problem on our flanks, but we were set up for it. It was as if it was a life or death matter. It was and it wasn't. But now you had 15 Antos online. So this looked real good. Well, it was and it wasn't. What happened was by the time we got over there, they had Bravo 1-1 or Charlie 1-1, but they had a rifle company that went to the end of the jet strip and promptly got shot up and pinned down. They were taking on a battalion of NVA and just basically ran across a 100-meter like plain or dirt road, a clearing, and just got shot up. And what they had to do to get cover was charge all the way to the end of like the tree line. But that the tree line was the NVA. So when they charged, you know, they were almost shaking hands with them. But they did a real good job of getting shot up and injured where they couldn't get themselves out. And then I think if they tried to get out, they're running the risk of getting shot in the back or shot again. So I don't think they were doing that. So they came up with the bright idea that we were going to get them out that couldn't get out. This is where it got dangerous. So what happened was they decided they'd take the Antos all the way over there, spin it around. You didn't have a lot of room. Told the loader to get lost. And we'd throw the wounded in the back. Well, this whole procedure took about 20 minutes. But it took about 20 minutes to figure this out. So now we're 40 minutes into this battle, and you got them pinned down in the trading shots. But the bad part was you were right on that tree line again, picking them up. You know, you could have, if they had a 9mm or a 45, they could have thrown their pistol at us, hit us in the head, and knocked us out. That's how close it was, or throw a grenade. But the bad part was they started shooting B-40s and RPGs at us. So I saw a few of them. And one of them went between the antennas perfectly. And later on, I made a remark to the driver who had survived Way City. I said, you saw God. He goes, what do you mean? I said, you had a near-death experience. He says, you know, I actually felt that go over my head. And I said, yeah, that was the jet stream or whatever it was, the heat from the rocket. At any rate, he was on a high for the next 2 weeks. We became best friends. His name is Tech Don Swanger. Re-enlisted in the Coast Guard to develop their emergency medical program. Stayed there to 2008, one of the senior people from Vietnam, still in the military after the 2008 or 2010. But he was the driver in the heavy section, and I saw that. And remember, I'm a new guy, 60 days, 90 days. But I'm rubbing in, I'm reminding him that rocket went over his head. Well, I shouldn't have been talking too much. We pulled a few people out. I was the driver. I hopped out. I helped people get them in, made a few trips. As it turns out, we cleared everybody out with probably in like 10, 15 minutes. And then I think anybody that was able to walk actually did walk out when the Antos went back. But what happened was we finally got up online and started to fire. And this is, now things are turning our way. A tremendous amount of firepower. So we had the high explosive plastic tracer rounds, which are called HE, except plastic meant it was composition B, a little more powerful than an average round. And then the tracer meant you saw a red glow when it fired. So it was pretty easy to follow. So that was our all-purpose round, and we fired most of them. I doubt if we wasted any heat on anything. But we mixed it up with flechette rounds, which was like a shotgun round with a dart. But the problem was we'd fire six rounds, and then we'd fall back. So nobody was staying up there. Everybody'd fire, and then all fall back. There was like no leapfrog approach here. So they'd fire and fall back. When we fell back, they were shooting rockets at us. And we were sort of laughing about it because now we're like 100 meters back. But the problem was we got out to load, and these rockets were skidding along the deck, the dirt. And as soon as they had to hit the dirt, they still would skid a little bit more. But at some point, they'd blow up. Everybody was getting hit in the leg with shrapnel. But the thing with the shrapnel, it was so far out, it felt like a sandblast, like somebody hit us with some sand or rocks. And it could have very easily been sand rocks. I mean, we had nicks and cuts in our legs, and I'm sure some people had more serious ones. But they weren't really doing any damage to the vehicle because they were detonating on the ground. But the situation was is that we were back 100 meters. I mean, we could have been back 300 meters. They were still going off, and when we were getting under load, you know, we were just thought it was like a laughable situation that we're invincible, they can't hurt us. Well, at any rate, we must have fired, and each Antos must have fired again another 30 or 40 rounds. We had ammunition all day long, or all day long, the next hour or so. Everything took place in about an hour. And we fired, you know, say 40 rounds times 15 vehicles was an inordinate amount of ordnance. So, or ammunition. So at any rate, everything calmed down, and then they put the got the infantry back there, and I said, oh, you know, we must have killed thousands. Well, we didn't. It was a battalion. I was a new guy, and I claimed, you know, I got some. I know these are mine. Antos got credited for 23 or 26 kills. So since I was talking about it, it was my first big battle, everybody said, we're going to give them to Rick. Rick is going to take the kills. He's going to get the kills. I said, yeah, put it down on my record, which they never do. But at any rate, we got 23 or 26 kills today. That was, I guess, my claim to fame on February 23rd. We never seem to have another day just like that. And then when they went to sweep through this forest or tree line that went on for about a mile, and it was bordered by another river, they had like three or four rivers there, they had three places to go. If they went east, they'd have to head to California or South China Sea. If they went north, they had to hit the jet strip. Well, they never did that. If they went west, they'd have to hit Highway 1 or Four Corners or Tank Battalion. I don't think they did that. So there was one way out, south. And they said, well, we got them now. They're all dead. No way to escape. Well, at any rate, they found 23, but what happened to the other 400 or 376? They walked on water or did something. They got to the river and just got out of there. Everybody says, well, it might have been a footpath bridge under the water. You wouldn't see it. They took it there. These guys are so smart. I think they could have got to the water and gone upriver, downriver. There could have been tunnels somewhere. But they just disappeared. At any rate, that was my first link that these VC and VA are pretty tricky. They're just not like a like the Revolutionary War with red coats, and they'll just stand up and let you shoot them. They basically got away, and a tremendous amount of firepower. I mean, there's no way we lost that battle, but there was no way that we eliminated 400 out of 400. I mean, 23 is probably not bad. I mean, I think we didn't have any KIs that day. They never had a KI since they came back to Da Nang from mine or RPG or anything. There might have been two or three people that put themselves in for Purple Hearts. I wish I had done that, but at the time we always felt, Purple Hearts, that's for sissies, and I'm not staying on the Marine Corps. What would I need these awards for? I'm not going to become a staff sergeant. I mean, everybody was a PFC or a Lance Corporal at the time, maybe a few corporals from way, but nobody's ever worried about how many medals we could have on our chest. Well, 50 years later, I'd say to myself, gee, I'd love to have a bunch of those. So after that, I think it was relatively peaceful, but we went back to norm again, going out to the OPs, bridge duty, convoy duty. Sometimes the convoy get ambushed and they turn the Antos around and start shooting at the ambush, and it would break it up pretty good. A couple times, 106s, they shot some B-40s or RPGs. It actually, they got lucky, it hit the 106, detonated. It blew the cannon right off the Antos. But the Antos didn't get wounded, or didn't get damaged, and the crew didn't get wounded. Or it didn't penetrate the hull. So we had a few of those. We're doing sometimes 20, 30 a night up at some of the OPs with, we're getting snipers, we're getting that. And it was the ultimate sniper weapon. You'd fire one of these 106s, and 1,000 meters away, it was an easy shot. It would silence any sort of small arm fire, or it seemed to silence it. So the infantry liked using us all the time. So my tour was relatively pretty good, but there was a new complexity that entered the picture. I guess they had the Woodstock generation, they had this happening, they had that happening, but President Nixon had just got elected, and he wanted troop withdrawals. And 327 or division wasn't stupid. They weren't taking out the 1st, 5th, or 7th Marine Regiment. They wanted to keep their fighting men there. I think they were trying to take out support groups, things that they felt weren't essential. So one of the ones they did was first ATs, they just had them, called a cadre, C-A-D-R-E. I still don't know what the definition is, but it sounds like you're making a unit idle. You're putting it like on ice, or you're putting it in cold storage. So first ATs had a final meeting on March 31st, 69, and they put it on ice. Well, except they decided to keep 5-10 Antos in reserve again for the division. But out of 180 men or Marines in that battalion or reinforced company, 160 went to the grunts, the different rifle companies. They went now from a tanker or 0353 to carrying an M16. And a lot of them were on extension. There were senior people that had done their 13 months, and now they're being sent to the infantry. I was one of the lucky ones. I stayed with first tanks, and I went out to one of the OPs, and it worked out well because they had some 106s there. And they said, I'll put you in charge. But at any rate, the Antos got parked, except for 5 or 10 that were still on bridge duty, or they allowed them to stay in battalion where they could fire up the motors. But still, 5 were evidently just deadlined or parked. But they actually did the same thing to to Alpha First Tanks. They took their 15 M48s and parked them as well. So Bravo and Charlie were still out at Hill 10 or Hill 55 and out in Anwa. But tanks actually took a hit also, where they decided that they were going to return them. Well, they didn't return them. According to me, I thought they'd return them in November. And I actually got a plaque from Antos. It's one of the best things I ever got out of Vietnam, or one of my treasured memories. It says, thanks for all the good duties from, December 68 to November 69. Even though I was gone in, May or June, it says I'm still with first stages in November. I'll take it. I like it. Yeah. But anyway, I think what it was is they were shipping them out around November. And then according to some other people, they had a final ceremony on March 1st, 1970. The whole tank battalion, 1st Tank Battalion, packed it up and went back to the United States. And 1st Tank Battalion was a rich battalion. They actually printed up a program for their final ceremonies and passed that around. So one of my friends that was in ATs was with the Major Duncan at the time, and he worked in the PX. He saved that program. So he can kind of document their final days. And then he says, I actually drove your Antos down to the Deepwater Pier. Okay. So even though the Command Chronicle said November was the end, we returned them. And it didn't make sense. That's the monsoon season, typhoons, a lot of things can happen. You know, March, you're going to have much calmer waters. And they were going back by boat to Barstow. So It ended up that they left sometime in March. Neontos packed them up. Meanwhile, I went to the OPs. They put me in charge of the 106s, thought it was a pretty good job, told them how, where to mount this, where that, got them to use flechette round, the dart round or anti-personnel rounds. Told them you're only gonna get one shot before they knock this gun out. We put it on top of a bunker. You couldn't really put it in a bunker for two reasons. One, it'd blow the back out. Two is if you wanted to elevate it or shoot it, you just didn't have much of a port to work out of. But three is you put it on top of a bunker, it's either can somebody with an AK or an RPG is just going to blow that whole tube off of there. So I used to always say to myself, you're going to get at least one shot off, or hopefully get one. Make it a beehive, point it to the wire, and have it preset for muzzle action. Well, they had never done that until I came out there. But at any rate, I came out there. They had all these infantry people. I would tell them, I'm in tanks. I've been here like 6-7 months. Oh, it doesn't count. You got to start over. You know, typical Marine Corps nonsense. But at any rate, within a couple months, I became the squad leader. And I decided that I was going to give up on the 106 to become the squad leader. I considered it a promotion. So I was in E3. We get a lot of salty people from tank battalion that were 1811s that were rotating back, had fought in Way. They had been over there in their extension. There were corporals or sergeants, and they had to listen to me. And they wouldn't. They'd actually say, I said, listen, the company gunny says whatever I say goes. There was even a staff sergeant there, and whatever I said went, because I ran the place and resupply, and I actually ran the radios and the squad leader. I told them to combine the jobs. It was a good idea. Mm-hmm. Turned out to be a bad idea, because they got overrun one night, and my replacement was the squad leader and the radio man. Well, they shot him. They took the radio. So now you didn't have communications, and now you didn't have a squad leader. So it was a bad idea, but until you found out how bad it was, it didn't seem like a good idea. So I decided to take that kind of position. But it was ironic that all the tankers that they sent out there for the last 30 days would not listen to me. And I said, listen, I got the ear of the company gunny. And I don't care what you have. I'm an E5. I'm not taking orders from E3. And the thing is I thought he did a pretty good job out there. It was an early warning system. We had any weapon we wanted from first tanks, 50 calibers, Browning, M60, M79, Starlight. We had multiple radios. We wanted canvas. Anything we wanted, we got. 106s. They even gave us C4. Got a lot of toys. All sorts of grenades. I didn't even know they made a Willie Peter grenade.
Yeah.
It weighed like a motorcycle battery. But at any rate, I had everything we wanted. And I did, I think, 5 or 6 months on that. They actually extended my tour a little because they thought I was doing a very good job to February 70. And they also, I was kind of a bad boy. I went to Sydney for Christmas, and they didn't want me to take it, but I was senior. And I was supposed to come back on December 31st. And I said, I changed it, so I came back a day later. I caught two holidays. Well, they said, well, you're going back out in the field. You're not a Jeep driver. He says, nobody would want you as a Jeep driver, but we kind of need you because we have all new guys. So I actually stayed well into February, an extra month, my 14th month. And I don't get any recognition for it, but my service in the Antos, because it's, a preferred vehicle or has notoriety or something, I get a lot of recognition for that. And at the same time, first AT since December 15, 67, all the way up to March 31st, 1970, even when they were on ICE or cadre, was under what John Ware would call OPCON. And what does OPCON mean? It means operational control. Their headquarters is merged with First Tanks, their command chronicles, their after-action command reports, their officers, everything is under the battalion commander there. And they actually, you know, if they were on the premises, they were in charge of them. If they went somewhere to an infantry unit, they might get what they call chopped. Now control goes to an infantry company leader. So I was under First Tanks with both, but it's interesting. The Antos is, the high spot in my Vietnam career.
Yeah.
So and then, you know, there's a lot of things along the line there. You know, we would help people. Occasionally we'd go someplace, was a firefight. You know, we need you to put a round in over there. Or we had a sniper over here, can you take him out? And a lot of times we didn't even bother, you know, getting a flechette round and fusing. We'd just fire a HEPT, and that was the end of that sniper. There was no more firing over there. As it turns out, one of those OPs got overrun in 1970, just the day after I came back. And it was a sapper squad or group, it was like 40 of them. And they did a rat patrol. They started over by 7th Engineers, went to IL-34, which was 7th Comm in the Army, went over to another group like MPs, went to the ammo dump, and on the way out they decided to hit that hill that it was on. And it was 40 of them, and I had a bunch of new guys, plus myself, and fortunately Lieutenant Johnson was with me. And the hill got overrun, and we fired back, and we had to go bumper to bumper, and we lost the comm bunker, we lost my replacement that was helping me, because I'd just gotten back. He got shot in the back. And you know, we didn't do hand-to-hand combat, but it was pretty close. And I shot one man, and we got a little bit of illumination. And I actually came up with the idea that if I can get a shot, I'm going to try to find out who their lieutenant leader was. So I got, maybe 3-4 seconds of illumination. And I caught the guy. He was only about 100 feet away. And you know, I was thinking about doing a headshot. And I said, what'd they teach you? I said, center mass. Mm-hmm. So I got him. And as soon as they lost that direction, that lieutenant, and that was the one KI we got, we might have wounded a few more, they all sort of disbanded. And then we were able to regroup, and then we found we had no radio, but we had some casualties. We had about 7 or 8 casualties that needed to be medevaced. So we had to send some people, like a little squad, not squad, like a little fire team, to another OP a couple miles down the road, whatever, 4 clicks, to get their radio, to get a helicopter. And they did. But that was a tough night, but it was different, because before I always had firepower from an Antos, and now it was an M16. And what was ironic is when I first came over there in January of 69, I had been up there with some other infantry, 5th Marines, and we shot there quite a few times because it was north and west. It was further out, isolated, than anything else. And now, exactly a year later, the place is overrun, and the Antos are on ice, cadre.